Hi, my name is Łukasz, and I would like to talk a little bit about plane approach, meaning that OSGI, which doesn't hurt the external world. And I will start from simple statement that Maven is the tool which has some proponents and it has lots of opponents with some reasoning behind this. And as you can find, there is 12,000 results of people who hate the Maven, and compared to them, OSGI is not a problem. We have much less haters of OSGI. So that's the first conclusion of today's talk. But the second one is that OSGI can be also a problem to some people who doesn't rely on it as a core thing. For us, guys who develop this stuff, it's great because we know it, but for anybody else outside, it represents some kind of the issue. For example, that's the open daylight slide about dropping the OSGI, and they point some of the issues which are also related partially to Caraf, which is used in the Open Hub. So, a few words about me. I'm contributor to some of the Open Hub projects. I did the backnet binding for 1x. Actually, I rewrote the existing one, so it's not my work. I just made it work. I support some basic questions on the Caraf and also did the security stuff lately. It took me a little bit long, but eventually it came in. And I also work as a Java consultant, and OSGI as is was my way of making living. So I make money from it. And I would like to start from a few slides about how world looks alike outside. I mean, I know the weather is nice, but I have sometimes the impression that we might have the echo chamber. So we hear ourselves a lot when we talk about the OSGI. And I know we are on the EclipseCon, but this is the community survey, which is based on 10,000 answers from Java developers. And as you can find, the IntelliJ has some market share, Eclipse have as well, and the NetBeans is still 11%. Not sure who uses that, but someone does. And if we will go further about build tools, Maven, sadly, is still one of the most popular. Gradle have about 19% of the market share, according to the guys who filled in this survey. And according to the guys who collected the answers, most of the guys use it for Android stuff, where there is no better way to build this stuff. Again, there is 11% of guys who still use Ant. Most likely, yes. And now let's talk about artifact repositories, because when we build our stuff, it has to go somewhere so we can distribute our lovely binaries. And 33% of people uses Nexus Artifactory, and some people doesn't use any. So the point is, those are so-called more or less standard tools and the standard setup of most of Java developers. And we have also comparison of testing tools. Again, JUnit is most popular. We have Mockito, but for example, we have also Selenium. Some guys want to do tests of the UI, so they run Selenium. And I'm gonna pay a lot of money to the guy who will make running Selenium under the OSGI. I mean, I never heard about anyone who did that. I don't know what for someone would like to run the browser inside of the OSGI, but the reason is that it's quite difficult to get it running. And then we have also runtimes. Again, the most popular is something which is not relevant to what we do. It's Tomcat, JBoss, Jetty. We actually use Jetty in the smart home, but the point is no one mentions OSGI here. So if we if we face the truth, the way how we do our stuff is a niche. Yes, yes. So, yes, there is a web sphere that there are some guys who live in the financial industry, but there was no answer if guys likes the way how this stuff is being deployed. Because I most of the answers about these three-letter company name products I heard was complaints. So I don't really want to go into any specifics, but the problem is that we are not friendly, from the OSGI point of view, we are not friendly to the guys who are doing regular development, because they might be doing it in a different way. It's not classified in the runtimes. Even if some of the servers, as pointed out, can run OSGI, we can run OSGI inside of web application. Those are the things which are not that popular. And there are lots of people out there who knows other tools quite well and doesn't know our stack that well. So if we will name the most named, this would be Tomcat, Maven, IntelliJ, and Eclipse. That de facto some standard set of the tools. And if we talk about the ecosystem which we try to maintain, the manifest is useless outside of OSGI world. It is. It doesn't bring any value to someone who wants to compile its own extension, its own plugin. So we need to provide some dependency information for the guys who try to write the extension so it will be useful for him. And then there is a way for doing that by delivering the bill of material POM. So this is the way, for example, how Spring Boot does it. Some Spring frameworks, some of them are built with the Gradle, but Spring Boot itself publishes the bill of material POM, which is possible to be imported and create so-called target platform definition. So it's not externalized, it's just one thing which you import into your build, and then your dependency management, your versions are set up. So you will not cross the boundaries of, you know, Spring-supported versions. Of course, again, Spring have some proponents and opponents, but that's the popular tool. If we would put in the comparison Spring Boot, it would be that high, and then I don't know if I would find the space to compare OSGI to it. I mean, we are talking about absolute numbers, not about the preferences. And I have few issues with Tyco, which I would like to mention. And of course, the colleagues from Deutsche Telekom already found out that there are some problems with it. So first of all, the offline mode doesn't exist. It always tries to reach the internet for whatever the reason. I mean, I know the reason, but it's not necessary all the time. The stability of the build is questionable. For me, when I was switching the branches, the build was breaking for no reason. That was my story. I complained a lot about that in the community forums, and there was no definitive fix for it. I don't know if it was outdated metadata or whatever. It didn't fly several times, and I was really, really, really frustrated about it. So Tyco, because it computes target platform upfront before every compilation, is slow. It takes on my old laptop 30 seconds to start build of single module. It's a waste of time. It's even slower than normal Maven. I mean, Maven is not the beast if we talk about the speed, but it's not that slow as Tyco plus Maven. There is also useless, so-called useless P2 metadata, which we produce for primary scenario, because we deploy stuff without P2. I mean, maybe it depends how the vendors are building their stuff, but P2 is great if we are in the Eclipse and we try to build the editor and so on, but for most of the use cases, it's unnecessary. No one uses P2 to build the dependency tree and so on outside of the Eclipse ecosystem. It's nice and extensible way of exposing the metadata, but it's useful only in the Eclipse ecosystem. Then we have also manually maintained manifest, lack of integration with standard repos, so if we have our own repository which we would like to pull stuff, and most importantly, if we would like automatically pull dependencies and manage their versions, with Tyco it's not possible because they have to be placed into this magic lib directory and then put into the manifest or whatever. And there is also no dependency information for end users. If someone imports the POM from our smart home project, he needs to put all dependencies of this dependency. So there are no transient dependencies, and that's one of the biggest failures. You can import smart home thing, and then you have to add smart home core and all other modules, even if this is a transient dependency of thing module. So that's how you get the target platform definition in Maven. That's how you stick with the versions used in the smart home. You import dependency management section, and then you get all the versions for all the artifacts, including Commons, Guava, and so on. So with this simple thing, your extension, which you can write aside, doesn't need to inherit from smart home POM. It can use its own compiler settings. You just bring the settings for versions, the binaries which you want to build against. And the core message which I would like to pass is that any Java developer can be productive with OSGI, but we need to make it friendly for them so they do not have to struggle with the details of OSGI as long as they do not have troubles with it. So by following basic convention, copy-pasting, they will be able to do the stuff in any editor, in any tool, without, you know, changing the way of working. And we can achieve that by providing better support for standard tools, and by this we will have also less complaints from the guys. I forgot to ask, how many of you used Maven here? Okay, quite a lot. Who hates it? Okay, we have few answers, and then the question is, who uses OSGI on a daily basis? Okay. So this covers more or less some of the answers. Less people uses OSGI than Maven, right? So if maybe if we will make it a little bit better, it will be better also for outside world. And there is a thing which I wanted to manifest, which is manifest is just another resource, and we don't need to maintain it. It can be generated. Users of the Eclipse, not Eclipse, but JBoss ecosystem and so on, they generate as much as they can because it shifts the load from the developer. And because if it's resource, then its importance is only for OSGI. So let's build it, but don't make it a religion. And if we can use annotations as Johan showed, that's great because it simplifies the life. And let's not maintain it if we don't have to, right? And if we talk about manifest, its main usage is Eclipse PDE and Maven plus Tycho. Okay, there is also OSGI runtime which uses that, but from tool perspective, which are used outside in the world, beside OSGI, no one uses that, right? And we already have the generators for doing some XMLs, which is the SCR generator from annotations to create the descriptors. So this is just a Maven plugin. We can also generate it for OSGI. So this. Yeah, so this Maven bundle plugin actually wraps the BND. So we have a BND tools and the BND tools Maven plugin, but this one is, I believe, older, which wraps the BND, the core of the BND tools. Okay. Okay, that's great. So these are copy paste from the web. Actually, I didn't try if it works, but it does. Because some of these plugins are actually used, even with our Tycho build. This one isn't used. But as you can see, you declare some stuff, and that's it, right? And the problem is, if we would have to put it in each and every module of our build, it would be productivity killer. So we can use some defaults. Those are actually defaults of Maven bundle plugin. So it uses the POM information, the project descriptor, to place some information. As you can see, by default, the import package is just a star, which means import everything which you have. And with some extended settings, creating the namespace, I know it's not the best way, but it's a convention which allows guys to copy, paste, and run. And let's go further. So this is some additional settings to remove the headers. I want to proceed to demo. That's why I'm speeding up. And then you can deploy it using the PAX URL, which supports different prefixes. So by default, when you deploy stuff, you can use file or HTTPS prefix. But for Maven repositories, you can use Maven URL, Maven URL prefix, which will scan directly your Maven repositories which you configure. And these are the formats of the versions which you can use. Sorry for speeding up. And now the core part, the testing, right? So the way how tests are run now with PDE build is OSGI runs JUnit and then just runs the test. And the way used outside is JUnit writes the runs OSGI container, which then embeds the test. And there are tools for that, Arquillion, PAX Exam. And Exam supports different containers, not only OSGI, so it can embed also Tomcat and run tests inside running Tomcat. And this is some basic test, obviously. And yeah, there is also Felix Connect, which simulates the framework without running the framework. So it's perfect for small unit tests, which doesn't require too much stuff. So it is not starting external process. It is unit test per as you would expect. That's how you can start it. So here is the mask for scanning the class path. So any module which is in the Maven class path, which is valid bundle, will be included, excluding the OSGI artifacts. And if you will follow this way, you will be able also to get the JUnit 5 support. So you're using JUnit 5 instead of JUnit 4. And the more fancier way of writing the assertions instead of Hamcrest or how it is called, which is really, really ancient. I don't understand why people use it. And now the demo time, as I said, I want to show you that some of this stuff actually works. And I managed to get JUnit tests, some of the JUnit tests running. And my point is not to demonstrate that it runs in the IntelliJ. The point is that it runs outside of the Eclipse, thanks to running on the Maven, right? It's, since it's standard description of the project, I didn't change layout of the project as well. So I didn't touch anything. And as you can see, for example, there is a test, core tests. I want to show you, okay, this thingy. So as you can see, this project I couldn't merge with Smart Home Core because it has dependency on Smart Home Core. So I had to leave it as the external, as the separate one. But I can run tests in from this project. Not sure if you are able to see, but these tests are actually running, and most of them is actually passing. And some of them are Java OSGI tests. So those tests are running this Felix Connect embedding the framework. So it works. Okay, there are some failures, and my computer is obviously quite slow, but as you can see, it works in the IntelliJ. And the major benefit is that most of the work which I actually had to do was adding some dependency information to the project, and that's all what I had to do. And this information will be visible to the outside world, so when someone will depend on Smart Home Core, he will also inherit these dependencies. So that's it from my side.